This is a story of survival, transformation, and triumph. It is the distance between people and places that is the catalyst for CSL's creation. But it is the extraordinary cooperation by an international community that enables the organization to thrive. For many years, the CSL story belonged to the Australian people. But today, it belongs to the world.
Ben was at a birthday party and he started saying he felt a little bit sick. He started to slip in the bath and he couldn't sit up. So in that moment, I said, I'm taking him to the hospital. He was so happy to get this icy pole. You know, they asked him what flavour he wanted. And he never got to finish it. He said, we've done everything that we can do for him. Now we just have to wait. He said, it's up to him.
In the final decades of the 19th century, scientific expertise blooms in the fields of bacteriology and immunology. Luminaries such as Pasteur and von Behring develop defenses against pathogens that have plagued humanity for millennia.
Most of the production was being done in state-owned entities, mainly in Germany and France and in Britain. And then the First World War came along and it disrupted the supply lines of those vital products to the rest of the world. Many countries, and Australia was one of those, decided that they had to become self-sufficient.
It's 1916 when the Australian government establishes the Commonwealth Serum Laboratories to service the health needs of their infant nation. The immediate focus is on the production of tuberculins, followed by a vaccine for smallpox. But their first true test is lurking over the horizon.
The Australian Imperial Force is waiting to come home, but there's no shipping to bring them home. They, like the rest of the armies in Europe, are located in massive camps. This is a perfect environment to spread disease.
As the winter of 1918 approaches, influenza spreads rapidly through the camps and is then transported with the troops throughout Europe, America, and the rest of the world.
How bad was 1918? Scary as hell. People were healthy one day, dead the next.
One third of humanity is infected. Tens of millions perish. It's little wonder that when the disease arrives in Australia, there is widespread panic.
Nobody knew what the cause was of this awful disease, but it was thought that vaccines made from bacteria might help to protect the community. And so CSL developed such a vaccine and delivered it to many people.
The people who received the vaccine were far less likely to contract influenza or to die from influenza. And so although the real cause wasn't known, the secondary effect of these bacteria was the thing that the vaccine was protecting against.
Australia's physical remoteness, an effective maritime quarantine, and CSL's tireless efforts help protect the country from the ravages of the disease. The experience affirms the government's investment in the laboratories and steels the world's resolve to prepare for future outbreaks.
Preparedness for influenza? Preparedness is the absolute key. If you're not prepared, you're going to get caught with your pants down. We've been so close many times.
The inability to identify the real cause of the disease is a major chink in the armor. It's more than a decade after the Spanish flu pandemic that scientists in the UK prove that influenza is a virus.
By putting samples from patients up the noses of ferrets, and the ferrets started to sneeze. And at that point, they knew they had isolated the influenza virus. They grew it then on into other species like mice, and eventually it was adapted to embryonated chicken eggs.
The egg-based production method proves to be remarkably resilient, with CSL and most influenza vaccine manufacturers continuing to use it more than 80 years after the initial discovery. What has changed is the scale. When CSL begins supplying influenza vaccine to Australian and British troops during World War II, they used 20,000 eggs per day. Today, it's close to 1 million eggs each and every day of production. With the identification of its cause and the development of a reliable method for mass production of vaccine, influenza appears to be coming under control. But then in 1946, it's discovered that the virus morphs.
Every year it's mutating and producing little changes that we have to try and keep up with.
And the influenza vaccine is the only one which is updated in this way every year or so.
It's a master of renewal, influenza, and I think we will never control it completely.
Reeling from World War II's unprecedented scale of suffering, the international community creates the United Nations to promote and facilitate cooperation across borders. Shortly after, the World Health Organization is established as the UN's agency for public health. For the first time, humanity has infrastructure capable of coordinating a global resistance against the influenza threat.
And they propose at the interim commission of the WHO that there should be a surveillance program for influenza to track what was happening with this virus, to learn more about it, so that vaccines could be made that would be protective and would be updated as required.
CSL becomes a WHO reference lab and later a collaborating centre, playing a crucial role in the monitoring of seasonal and pandemic influenza strains. The network does detailed comparisons of viruses from around the world, meeting in Geneva twice yearly to make recommendations for both the Northern and Southern Hemisphere's seasonal vaccines. In addition to producing its own vaccine, CSL also provides an essential service for other vaccine manufacturers.
By producing the seed viruses from which the vaccine will ultimately be made. And it does that for WHO and shares its seed viruses with other manufacturers.
With each of the global pandemics that follow the Spanish flu, CSL proves the effectiveness of its preparation. While the steady transition to a globalized world increases the speed at which contagion spread, this is mitigated by continual improvements in diagnostics, communications, and vaccine manufacturing capability. And overall, it seems the trend is towards a diminishing impact. But a repeat of the horrors of 1918 is entirely possible at any time, should an unexpected mutation emerge in conditions that circumvent our defenses.
Health experts have moved closer to declaring the first flu pandemic in 40 years.
Very similar to the 1918 influenza. Scarily so. From a molecular point of view, and a structural point of view, they were essentially identical.
Armed police are guarding Mexico City's hospitals, reportedly turning people away.
It wasn't what we were expecting. All the planning had been for an avian flu.
Based on the pattern of illness that we're seeing here in the United States, we don't think that this virus can be contained.
It was here before we knew it. It was spreading before we knew it.
It really is all of humanity that is under threat during a pandemic.
He was on the life support machine. So that machine was breathing for him.
As soon as this became an issue of concern, we were talking to CSL about what was needed. The fear you have with pandemic is that it will get worse, that the virus will mutate, and that many people will die before you can actually roll out a vaccine.
They explained that in, you know, a small percentage of people, their body reacts by killing the flu virus, but then it doesn't know when to stop, so it starts to attack the brain stem. if there'd been a vaccine available, we would have definitely had him vaccinated and had all of our family vaccinated.
And then the breakthrough. A vaccine emerges from the global community of scientists, and CSL's production expertise ensures Australia is one of the first nations to provide this protection to the public.
I can still see the meeting that we had where the data were put in front of us to show that we got the reaction we wanted. People were just really, really thrilled. It was one of those very good moments in health and in science.
2009 could have turned out very, very differently.
We do consider ourselves very lucky that he has been only left with a sort of mild left-sided weakness, which means that he goes through a lot of left shoes quicker than his right.
When we're thinking forward, where will the next influenza virus come from? If it's a repeat of a virus that's been in the human population previously, the result may be similar to 2009. If it's a virus like the H5N1 or the H7N9 viruses that are currently circulating in other parts of the world with a very high mortality rate, around 50% of the infected people die, it could be a very different story.
In the wake of the crisis, CSL's flu business arrives at a crossroads. While pandemic response offers a spike in sales, the industry's slim profit margins demand a major investment in scale to compete. And with new technologies threatening to make its flu products obsolete, CSL is forced to consider divestment or risk slow death. Before we explore the decision, there's a lot more we need to understand about CSL's story.